There isn't a person that I've spoken to that isn't fascinated and excited by the groundbreaking work that MYND Life Sciences is doing behind their patented biomarker that can not only be used to diagnose depression and Alzheimer's disease, but a world's first ability to physically detect them within the human body. In order to take a further dive into this company and what they've been working on recently, I'd like to welcome back CEO, Dr. Lyle Oberg. My good sir, welcome back.
Thank you very much and good morning.
Good morning to you as well. I'm excited to have you. And before we start talking about the exciting things that your company has been doing since we last spoke, I'd like to take a moment to focus on the current opportunity at hand for investors with where your stock price and company valuation are today. Because there seems to be a disconnect for whatever reason between the potential of the work that you're doing with new investors buying into your story. What do you believe may be causing the lack of open market buying when what you're working on can quite literally revolutionize the world of treating depression and Alzheimer's disease as we know it?
Yeah, it's a really interesting question. The work that we're doing is obviously important. It's obviously very legitimate, taking place at the University of British Columbia. But I think a couple of things happened. I think initially there was a lot of enthusiasm, so our stock price shot up quite high. And the people then have held on to that stock, and subsequently the stock price has come down. But also, I believe there is a bit of hesitancy because people are comparing the psychedelic market to the cannabinoid market. And I think we all know what happened to the cannabinoid market, when in actual fact, these two things are very different. And what I like to tell people is that instead of comparing it to the cannabinoid market, you should be comparing it to the biotech market, taking a look at the upside of bringing forward a new class of drugs that potentially could cure and help hundreds of millions of people worldwide. And that's not an exaggeration, Brandon.
Yeah, and I think you're very correct by saying that, because everyone does know what happened to the cannabis space. And we were speaking offline prior to this, talking about cannabinoids and how when you're trying to make a drug out of them, it's actually very hard because the bioavailability of them is so different from one person to the other. Whereas with psychedelics and with certain things, you can really, really get down to the nitty gritty of it and make sure that every single time you're using a certain drug, a certain process, it's the exact same. And in the biotech world, that's very, very important. So I'd actually like to jump onto that, because I'd like to switch our focus now into what investors should be excited about the work that you're doing, but specifically in the case of your new subsidiary that you just created to fully capture the value of your diagnostic biomarker division. What will this division be focusing on? And we spoke about biotech and how those things can be very long and sometimes without revenue, but this one's different because you're saying that you're going to begin generating revenue within the first half of 2022. Can you explain that?
Yeah, absolutely. So with depression, for example, in the past, it has been thought that literally, and no pun intended, that depression is in your head, that it's in your mind. What we've shown is that actually depression is a physical disease, not unlike rheumatoid arthritis, not unlike many of the other inflammatory diseases. So when you have that physical cause, you can actually have a biomarker that detects when it's getting worse, and when it's getting better, and when it's there. And that's critically important when it comes to diagnosing, because up until now, it is the psychiatric diagnoses have been with what is called a DSM-5, which stands for, and if you get this, it actually stands for Diagnostic and Statistics Manual. So it's purely a compilation of statistics as to what symptoms occur with certain diseases. It's very, very subjective. It is not objective at all. Well, now what we are bringing forward is an objective analysis of what can determine whether or not you are depressed, and probably more importantly, whether you're getting worse or getting better, because that can institute treatment at an earlier stage and stop those deep, dark, depressive moments that people have.
Yeah, and that's very fascinating to me, because I think everyone in one way or another has someone in their family, a close friend, a coworker who suffer from these syndromes or these depression, Alzheimer's disease. We spoke about this in our last interview. Having that in the family is just absolutely devastating. So to be able to actually diagnose it, like you said, in the body and understand is the work that you're doing, not just helping from the way that person looks and sounds and is speaking, but in their actual body, are they getting better? That's fascinating.
Yeah, and I think everyone knows and everyone has asked themselves a question, well, why is that person depressed? Why did that person kill themselves? It looks like they had the world in front of them, and yet they were depressed. So this all points to it being a cause. And if we can identify that cause, which we feel we have, if we can have a marker that actually tells when that cause is getting better or when it's getting worse. Better is important too, because it allows people to go off of medication. And, you know, again, depressed people often are scared to go off medication because the consequences of becoming depressed again are so debilitating. So it works both ways. We can detect when you're getting better and when you're getting worse. So we can treat early. And that's a key to many illnesses, but certainly depression in general.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. And sticking with treatment of depression, you recently just announced being a part or an integral part of a 2B clinical trial to test the efficacy of psilocybin assisted psychotherapy in the treatment of people diagnosed with treatment resistant depression. Can you expand on this trial and what it means for your company, but also potentially for the people involved?
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, it starts off as a 2B, but it is predicted to be in a phase 3 clinical trial within 12 months. And that's actually one of the criteria that we put in it. It's done with a group out of Monash University in Australia. And interestingly enough, the Australian government, in their foresight, has given the area $15 million to study psychedelics and depression. So that's very, very forward thinking for a government to do that. And we have put an application in, we have put a full process in on how to get to stage 3 clinical trials using what's called an adaptive trial almost immediately. And the nice thing from our point of view is that our biomarker is being used to evaluate this. So again, we will be evaluating a particular treatment in a stage 3 clinical trial. So this is huge for our company because it validates everything that we're doing and validates it very quickly. You know, obviously, it's a reputable university. Being with the Australian government is great. So it's not as though this is being done in some corner in some foreign country. This is Australia.
And that's fantastic. And I'm very excited to see that begin, but more importantly, see the results of those trials to come. Lastly, what should investors be excited about looking out in terms of, you know, news flow and maybe different trials and how they're progressing? What should they be looking for coming down the pipeline to end 2021, but also begin the new year, which is now right around the corner?
Yeah, it's amazing how time flies. But investors can be really excited about our company moving forward. With the biomarker, we're looking at the ability to detect depression in postpartum. Postpartum depression is a debilitating disease. You have a normal, healthy woman who has a traumatic event, which is the birth of a baby, and becomes depressed 5 or 6 days afterwards. We feel we can detect who is at risk for that. We can detect when to treat it and to treat it early before these devastating results occur. And that occurs in 10 to 15% of all pregnancies. So this is a very common illness, and we feel by detecting it, it'll be able to help. We're also looking at, we were very, very excited when our scientific team came out with a paper in The Lancet, arguably the top journal in the world, which shows how to regress Alzheimer's disease. And this is not stopping, it's not slowing it down, but it's actually improving and having people with Alzheimer's disease get better. And what we're seeing in mice trials is that these mice are actually regaining their faculties. So huge, huge step forward, and we'll be expanding on that in the upcoming year. We're also looking at many other diseases where this same inflammation, this neuroinflammation in the CNS, seems to be causing a lot of other illnesses. Multiple sclerosis, well-known inflammatory disease. If we can take a step forward in preventing and or stopping and or regressing that, just think of what that does to the people. So we're very, very bullish on this upcoming year. We're very, very optimistic about the things that we're doing.
Yeah, and honestly, it truly is fascinating and amazing how many of these ailments, how many of these issues come back to inflammation in our bodies. And once again, to be able to diagnose that, to be able to treat it, to be able to see it for once, but then also using psilocybin, which many people are now starting to realize more and more is an anti-inflammatory, and it's used to help with that. Very, very excited about the work that you're doing, Dr. Oberg, and very thankful once again for your time today. I look forward to being able to have you on in the near future to continue to talk about these trials as they continue to progress as well.
Thank you very much, Brandon. It's great.